has going to aid his title fight very, very nicely. So Ender's second lane and back in the lead on that 20, but after Ender's leading quite a large stint, it's going to be kind of push to see who gets that point for the most laps, especially if Ender's can get his game on and gets towards the rear end of Lennon.
Yeah, I just checked what happened to Jose there. It looks maybe like a computer issue or something happening in the background, because he just seemed to have drifted off the circuit, slowed down, parked on the racetrack before moving off again. So he's dropped down to ninth place, which is a shame because he was looking very handy.
Yeah, absolutely. But the gap between Lennon and Ender's at the moment is 6 seconds. So, of course, that can all come crashing down with the slightest incident. And it looks like it is. Pete's actually gained around 2 tenths through that sector, it looked like. So Ender's has got his head in the game at the moment. Got to be careful not to overdo it, though. Especially when you're chasing someone down, the tensions will get higher and you want to push as hard as you can. But you have to remember the slightest slip-up could set you back a good 5 or 6 positions.
Yeah, and it looks like the driver who gained the most is this man, Mark Foley.
Ooh,
he's running low as 10th place, but courtesy of some drama in the pit lane and Hosey's issues, he's managed to pull himself up to a very handy position, followed by George Talbot some 14 seconds behind.
In a comfort zone at the moment then, Mark Foley. He's put himself sorted. He's just needs to try and keep in that zone. He's got a decent gap between the car in front and behind, so he could potentially drive home in a very well-deserved 5th place.
Indeed, but the man not in a comfort zone is this man, George Talbot.
He's got a nice train of cars behind him.
Indeed, Matt Strand, and what I can only assume is a very, perhaps not angry, but upset Andreas Eriksson.
Yep, Eriksson, of course, down to 8th, and he said he's going to try and carve his way back through the field after being 2nd place after the start. He's pushed down the field, but he's going to try and come back into this now.
And he's under pressure from another man who's had a strange race, Jose Mura. Looks like this is the battle here. The bottom end of the top 10. Eric's just running wide there on the exit of the final turn, allowing Jose through. Jose looking very, very strong at this point. I suspect that Eric's still struggling with damage from the early contact with Tim Brook. It's going to allow Jose just to make his way up through the field rather swiftly.
Yeah, so Jose Mura, so things with Jose Mura and Eriksson, these two, those very feisty drivers who deserve to be higher than they are. So let's see Mura then, and he's trying to do everything he can to put a move into P7. He's got a nice stint, he doesn't want to duck out too early there, and I think he's going to lose a bit of time there. But he's going to have to break very, very late. I mean, you think better of that because, of course, you've got a very feisty Eriksson just behind.
Yeah, it looked like Matt Strand just maybe applied a little bit more boost there as Jose makes a very risky sneak of the nose into the Toyota Bridge corner. Don't want to be doing that, but I think maybe Matt just applied a little bit of extra boost there to help defend his position. Of course,
yeah,
Matt was...
pretty smart move. Look at your leader. It's just the flying lap, the fastest lap of the day so far. 142.176, but one man will be looking to do that. It's Jose Mura. He's trying desperately to try and get past Matt Strand at the moment.
Yeah, if he picks it up here, if he maybe adds a little bit of extra boost, he's able to. He should be able to make the move down to Canada corner. Here he goes, he's in the slipstream. Going to pull out to the outside, maybe have a look down at the inside. Thinks better of it. It's Eriksson, looks like Eriksson spins.
Well, that is catastrophic there then, and it's gone from bad to worse for Eriksson, your race winner of Daytona. As we take a look at the replay then, going quite well at the moment, and then I think he's just got a bit too lurry out the corner, and you see Jose Mura trying desperately for a move. Yeah, he just went out of room into the back of Mura, and nothing he could do there. I think he was caught out by the Mura trying to break him. He's got it back to pit road, it looks like, but that is catastrophic. So after being second on the grid, he's now found himself down in ninth.
And here comes Jose looking at Matt Strand in turn 2. Is he going to go for it? Yes, he is. And we've got a spun out car there. Is that Andrews Nilsson, is it? There definitely was a car spun out there. I have no idea who it is.
Yeah, so look at Matt Strand. He's actually under a bit of pressure, and I think he's off the position.
Looks like he did. He got overtaken by Jose into turn 2, but he's managed to retake the position down into turn 3.
So look at this, then, side by side once again, and after a very risky move. He pulled it off fantastically there. Great job.
That was a great move there by Jose. Just pushed Matt out and just took the place. Obviously got a lot of confidence in the mechanical grip of the car there to be able to make that move, and now he's looking to take a place off George Talbot, who's sitting in sixth place right now.
I mean, with a move like that, you know, breaking that lane, you have to have full commitment to the move. You cannot back out of it in corner. It's got to be 100% committed, or you could just think, if you think better of it halfway through the corner, then you're just going to find yourself in a pile. So,
especially in that corner, a very tricky one just to get it right. As I was saying at the beginning of the broadcast, these cars tend to lose all their grip and all their downforce as they crest the Toyota Bridge Hill. Jose was very skillful in just linking it up there, picking it down inside of Matt, and just making sure that Matt knew that there was no chance really of being able to defend that, as he looks now to put George Talbot down a place.
Yep, of course, these two running identical liveries as Murray goes out, and I'm sure there's going to be no fighting there from George Talbot. Of course, these two both drivers for Inspire Motorsports, I believe.
Jose's driving for Atlantic Racing.
George, 05. Same livery, though, which is why it could be confusing, but let's see what Murray can do then. He's definitely asked a good move up the inside. It's a bit risky. They got pushed to the edge of the track, forcing George the outside line, and there was nothing. George is not going to surrender that one. He's gone a bit wide though, and given Murray the run up the hill. And now I think he's going to have to surrender it now though. It was a good fight by Talbot, but Murray's on a complete rampage at the moment.
Yeah, that was George being very forceful, just making sure Murray knew that he wasn't going to get the chance to go down the inside, but George was his own enemy there. He just ran a little bit wide on the exit turn 3 and allowed Jose to hook up what seems to be his favourite passing place into the Toyota Bridge corner, as Peter Enders, our P2 man, has set the fastest lap of the race. And is that an overheating Jose Mura? It is.
It is, and that's not the way he wants to go. So Mura, I think, has done a bit too much. I mean, he's going to have to try and call the engine down because he's lost one position. Don't fight for it, but he's not the kind of guy to back off. And I think that's going to be hurting him quite a lot now, knowing he can't do anything to try and get onto the back of the escaping George Talbot.
Yeah, I suspect Jose's going to have to turn down the boost or something, because that engine is just not going to last as George moves to the off the racing line to avoid that Europe
at all. And so, very disappointing there for Jose Murray. He's going to have to do all that work again. Just pushed a bit too hard, I think, and he was making some daring moves. And it was some brilliant racing, but it's just got a bit too much for the engine. It couldn't quite hack it, and it's going to have to try and just, as I say, leave off the boost a bit. I mean, the smoke's starting to fade now, slightly. Maybe not, but...
I think he's probably just run that car to its maximum boost, trying to get back these positions, and perhaps over-revved it a couple of times, and he's just caused the car to get to that point where it looks like he's not going to be able to easily cool it down with... Perhaps he's going to have to just turn down the boost and short shift it for a while to try and get that engine cooled, because if it continues to smoke like this, I can't imagine him lasting the final 15 minutes of this race. And back to the front,
yeah. So
Peter Enders.
It's actually Peter Enders leading now, so where's Leinen? He's going to be quite interesting. We've missed this, so Tim Brooks second,
Brooke.
So Leinen stands to third, is that? And Nilsson's
third, so... Well, what have we done? Here he is.
Then, so what's happened? Maybe he has to make, I mean... If you think back to how early he made the pit stop, it could have well been a second stop for Leinen.
I'm just going to try and work that out for you.
I mean, he stopped, probably about 10 laps in, I think. It was a very, very early stop, and it was a good 5-10 laps earlier than most other drivers, so he needs to, maybe that's what it was. I mean, there's not a huge chunk of time lost. He's only 5 seconds away, though, however, from Mark Foley, so I think we'll be very happy to move up another position.
Indeed, as we suspected, or not necessarily suspected, but have guessed that Mr. Leinen has made an extra pit stop. So that early pit stop, although it looked like it had worked for him, has maybe not done exactly what he wanted it to do for him.
No, and the thing is, though, stopping that early is a great move, but he's got himself, I think, maybe he knew he didn't quite have the pace to be at the front. I mean, he was looking extremely handy. And he's got himself as far from in front of people as he could, but I think just the tyres gave up on him towards the end. I mean, you're not going to want to try and drive a car with, you know, degrading tyres at that rate, because it will get scary and you don't want to bin the car with just a matter of minutes to go.
Yeah, I think Leon has just tried to maybe combat the outright pace of some of the other drivers on the grid by running shorter stints. Maybe he was running a higher boost, allowing himself just to make a bigger gap, as big a gap as he could, as quickly as he could, so that he would be able to fit these pit stops in. Unfortunately, it looks like Peter Enders, Tim Brugge and Anders Nielsen have got one up on him this time, because I'm not sure that Leonen, almost one sector behind our P3 man Anders Nielsen, is going to be able to claw this one back. See if we can find you some action on the grid. We lost Jose. We have lost Jose. Here he is. Like his engine maybe gave up. As Leonen sets the fastest lap of the race. Looking to recover as quickly as he can. He has got 12 minutes, so it's not beyond the realms of possibility that he could catch up to the battling pair of Anders Nielsen and Tim Brugge as they go down into turn 3. Anders Nielsen, the tortoise of the server, looking very, very racy.
Well, probably the tortoise has got him up towards the podium position, perhaps fighting with Tim Brugge, who, well, don't want to add any more paint to his collection going on the side of his car, so Tim just want to try and drive the car home to a second place. But, I mean, both these guys have had very, very good races at them, so.
Yeah, and they've both gone about it in two rather different ways. Tim's put his nose in there, he's battled hard for positions, he's taken his chances, made a pass, defended as hard as he can, he's really worked hard for it, whereas Anders Nielsen's kind of done the opposite strategy. He's just let the race come towards him, and now as we come into the final 10 minutes, it's Anders Nielsen who's looking maybe a little bit stronger than Tim. He looks to just maybe have the edge as we come into the final part of the race, which is exactly what he managed to do at Daytona 2 weeks ago, where he wasn't necessarily languishing for the early part of the race, but he wasn't up with the pace of the other drivers. But now as we come in to the final 10 minutes, he's able to eke out that extra pace, push the car that little bit harder, maybe run a higher boost just to keep plucking away at those positions.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you don't want to bend it, you know, with 11 minutes left. Maybe it'll be sensible to just try and back off and settle for third, but to be fair, Leonen's not too far behind, so you don't want to try and bend it straight away. As I say, I mean, Leonen would quite happily capitalise on a mistake.
Yeah, I don't know. Leonen's not really sure. I think his pace has been really good anything on the low fuel. I mean, it's been very, very good on the low fuel. He was able to pull out quite a large gap to Enders. I'm sure what his reasoning was for going on this rather unconventional strategy. I suspect that had he stuck with what would be the strategy that every other car has run, he may actually still be leading this race, but as it stands, I still think that he's just a little bit too far away to catch up to the Anders Nielsen-Tim Brugge battle.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, though, I mean, since the start of the race, there's been such a position swap between everybody. I mean, you had Leonen and Ericsson, you know, the two quickest guys out there, both showing superb efforts during Daytona. Now, Ericsson is very far down the field, and you've got Leonen down in fourth after a very risky pit strategy. And now you see Ericsson down in eighth, going to try and he's also back with 9 minutes to go. He's got enough time to try and catch Strand.
Yeah, but again, I think we know that Ericsson had a pretty big hit with Tim Brugge at turn 3, possibly damaging suspension there. We know that Ericsson has careered into the back of Jose at Canada Corner, so I wouldn't be surprised if Ericsson, as we ride on board of him now, is just combating some sort of damage in that car, whether it be aero suspension or some sort of steering arm effect. I'm not sure he's going to be able to challenge. Certainly not going to be able to pick up a podium position at this stage. I think the very best you'd hope for is top 5, but even that is a very, very tall order now as we come into the 9 minutes remaining of this race. I think Ericsson's just got to try and keep it on the track and pick up what points he can now.
Yeah, it's
going to
be interesting. Strand in 7th, looking pretty nice, just the fourth behind George Talbot. So we could see these three come into battle during the final stages of the race. I mean, we've seen, especially in Daytona, that was a huge battle. I think it was Mohamed Patel was involved in that. And it came right down to the wire. There's still, you know, 6-7 laps remaining in this race, so he's never got anyone off.
Yeah, I'm just trying to look at the Leonen versus Nielsen battle. The gap is still just a little bit too large for him to be able to do anything as we come in with 8 minutes remaining. I just think Leonen has shot himself in the foot, really. I can't really see the benefit of the strategy he ran. It did get him out in front, but he wasn't able to pull a large enough gap that he was able to keep himself on the podium. He looked quicker in qualifying, so I'm really a little bit confused with the choice of strategy there. I would have thought that had he run the more conventional strategy, that he would probably be fighting with Tim and Anders here, and probably Anders for the win. Had he just stuck with the conventional strategy as it is now, it looks like he's going to have to settle for fourth place.
Yeah, but one thing that isn't settled is Tim Brook trying to fight with Anders Nielsen. So let's see if Nielsen will go on the aggressive. But I'm sure if this is the other way around, you'd see Tim Brook trying to find every possible way around. But Nielsen seems to be relaxed and quite calm at the moment.
Yeah, Nielsen's just doing what he's done the entire race. It's just keep it nice and steady, not taking any risks. I don't think we've seen any errors from Nielsen. The only slight off that he had was when he got a little bit too close to the charging at Andreas Eriksson after Eriksson's first mistake, where the two came together and Anders suffered worse there, running a little bit wide and dropping a couple of positions. But now he's very much on the offensive. With not long to go now, I'd expect Anders, if he can, to just increase the boost level and just maybe break that a little bit later and try and hit the throttle a little bit harder, just to try and eke himself even closer to Tim. It won't take much. Both of these guys are on roughly the same strategy. Anders pitted one lap after Nielsen, so Anders has perhaps a little advantage there. But yeah, this is going to come down to the wire, this one, as we'll go on board with Anders coming lap. So here we go with Anders Nielsen, currently in third place behind Tim Brook. He starts lap 30. Got a pull there from Tim Brook, so thinks better of it, breaks a little bit early. Hits his apex perfectly, runs just onto the exit curb. Going to want to try and get as close to Tim as possible as he comes into here. If he can, turn up the boost, get into Tim's track. Looks like he might be a little bit too far away right now. Come down into turn three, a very difficult hard braking zone. Try and get the brake as late as possible. Closes the gap up to Tim slightly. Tim getting very squirrely.
But Nielsen does very well to avoid it and take the position, so it's going to be a smile on Nielsen, but it's nowhere near from over yet. Tim Brook will be quite angry. It'll be nice to see if that actually affects his driving style then. He's going to try and do all the work now in the remaining 5 minutes to try and latch on to the back of
P2. Yeah, I thought Anders had braked quite late there. Tim wanted to try and be the last of the late breakers and just got a little bit too hot on the brakes, maybe snatched the brakes just as he turned in. But the car into a slide, and that's just the perfect opportunity for Anders. He's just got himself into a position where he's pushed the issue long enough that he's close enough to win these. The mistake was there if he was able just to sneak through, and that's what Anders would be very good at this race. And that Daytona was just sticking with someone, not necessarily forcing the issue, but just waiting for whatever was going to happen to make his move. And now he's looking to, well, he is pulling quite a substantial gap away from Tim as we come into 4 minutes to go.
Yep, so it's
going to
get extremely tense now. Then of course, if you look in the background, you've got Leonen and coming towards the home straight now then.
Yeah, Leonen.
Yeah.
14 seconds off Tim Brook with 4 minutes to go. Not sure he's going to be able to do this. His pace has dropped considerably. He was set 141 at the start of his stint after that second pit stop. He's now dropped into the 44s. And to give you an idea, Tim, even when he was battling with Peter Enders, has dropped out of the race. So, Andrews Nelson
leads. No. So what's happened there then? Surely is that a disconnecting error? I mean, Enders.
That's
been
an engine failure from Peter Enders.
Peter's
second race in a row.
Hello?
So what's happened out there?
I don't know. My engine burned again. Oh, damn.
You need to take better care of her.
It's a Ford engine. Maybe that's why. I don't know. Yeah, I didn't boost a lot. I just boosted a little bit with two, but not, just for a few moments. So I was really wondering. Maybe it's the downshifting or whatever, which caused damage to the engine. I don't know. Well, I was watching some TV documentation about elephants, and I thought everything was okay, but, yeah.
So, what was your view of the race then, Peter, like, from the start? Talk us through what you actually went through today.
Yeah, it was actually a good qualifying for me. And then the start, it was fine to find, it was really hard to find the rhythm. I had some, an incident with, I think it was Leinonen, or I can't remember the name. I basically, at the end of the finish straight, I blocked the inside of the corner. Yeah, Ericsson. I blocked the inside and there was no way, and he tried to, you know, go really to the inside with some glass, and I was a little bit shocked or whatever, and then moved a little bit over, and then I already saw him, you know, going wide, and I hope he didn't crash. Yeah, and then so far, I had some problems to find the rhythm. Like I said, I made mistakes and lost the lead because of this, and then I was wondering why Leinonen comes to such an early pit, because I thought that we all are on a one-stop strategy, and it was a little bit weird. Can you guys tell me what happened to my teammate Jose after his stop, because he was right behind me?
Yeah, Jose. Like, I think he maybe had personal something happening in the background with his computer, maybe someone talking to him, because he pulled over at the side of the track and stopped, and then he got back underway, and then he overheated his engine, and then his engine eventually blew up.
Yeah.
As it looks like we're coming on to the last lap here at Road America, Anders Nilsson leading with Tim Brook in second, and Leonenin, who we've just heard from Enders, was on a rather strange and perhaps not so wonderful strategy, is coming under a lot of pressure from charging Mark Foley. He's got one lap to do it. Will Mark be able to take this position off Leonen?
Well, never say never. 35 seconds left, so it will be one more lap, and it's nowhere near from over.
I think this will be the last lap, because Andrews crossed the line with 40 seconds to go. So Andrews, your leader, with a very fiery Tim Brook behind him as Tim gets very close to Anders.
And this is going to be very tense in the final lap. He said it would go down to the wire. Here comes Tim Brook then on the assault. Nilsson shuts the door very awfully there.
Yeah, well, you could say that, but I don't think Tim's ever going to be able to make the move around there. And Anders just made sure that Tim knew that wasn't going to happen. But Tim looking very racing here. Maybe he's just up the boost. We're coming through the carousel. Tim needs to get very close, get in the draft of Anders, and make that move into kind of the corner, as this will be the last lap.
Yeah, so it's going to get extremely tense. The timer has hit zero. This is last chance to lose. As we like to say, Tim Brooks for the win then. On the inside of Anders Nilsson. Can he make it stick? It's a fantastic move. And I think he's in the wall! Tim Brooks at the final hurdle. His spun, he's in the wall, he's lost the front wing. Can he guide it home for second place? He's asking how much should have left laps to go, and we'll try and get some opinions from him towards the end, but that means that Anders Nilsson, under the most unlikely circumstances, the tortoise of the session, claims victory at round three of the SRO Carfrat, the championship. What a brilliant drive by that young man. Brilliant to watch. And second place, it could have been so much more, but Tim Brook comes across the line in second. Third place will be Leonen, I believe.
Yeah, with a very good guy, Mark Foley. He just wasn't able to do it. So Mark Foley brings the car home in fourth. Ericsson has fought his way back up the grid from a rather disappointing session for him to fifth place. This is coming up to the finish line now. as we have a car stopped on the circuit. It's Matt Strand, so that's going to promote George Talbot into sixth place. Matt Strand with an engine failure on the last lap.
Oh, happened here. I mean, what a brilliant race. This series just never fails to deliver, it has to be said. So it's just been, like, absolutely fantastic. We've had catastrophes at the start, drama in the middle, and then it's all come down to the wire at the end.
I'll give you a rundown of your final finishing order. The top 10 cars, Anders Nilsson claims the win. Tim Brook follows in second after a courageous battle in the final lap. Samuel Leoninen, he finishes up in third place. Mark Foley, fourth place. Andreas, Eriksson, brings the car home in fifth. Matt Strand is still out on the track. His car is stranded, but he is classified as sixth place. George Talbot sitting in seventh position. Nick Phillips, eighth place. Peter Enders, with his engine failure, finishes ninth place. And John Clark, our final classified driver, finishing up, rounding out the top 10. Our DNFs, Jose Mura, Simon Wattman, both of engine failures. Bella Stenbeck, Timo Toika, Jim Dickel, Mohamed Patel, and Jordan Wex, all suffering incidences during the race. And that finishes your race here at Road America from SRO.
Absolutely brilliant. I mean, so obviously, I think for me, driver of the day has been Anders Nilsson from the very start. You know, he started at a bit of a disadvantage, but just been Mr. Consistent throughout the whole thing. You know, never put himself in any danger of losing position or anything. Just kept the car going on track, and look where it's landed him.
Yeah, I was going to, as Matt Strand gets a push by Leoninen to finish the race, I was going to see Tim Brook as my driver of the day. Tim was very, very feisty and exciting to watch, made passes, had some great racing. Had he pulled off that final move on Anders Nilsson, it would have cemented his position in my mind as driver of the day, but Anders' slow and steady approach to the race didn't take many risks. He survived the carnage almost at some points at the front of the field and managed to make the pass on Tim in the final laps of the race and then defend a very courageous move from Tim. I think we have to say, yeah, unequivocally, that Anders Nilsson is our driver of the day.
Very well deserved title. I mean, we'll try and get a few of these drivers in for interview if we can, especially Anders Nilsson. It'd be great to hear from him.
And all the drivers are now have completed the race and returned back to the paddock. Hopefully we can get a couple of them up here into the broadcast studio and have a wee chat with them following the end of that race.
So just trying to wait for the drivers. I mean, I'm sure Anders Nilsson will be a very happy man right now. And he had to defend it like crazy on the final lap as well. And of course, a thrilling end, just like it was in Daytona. So, wow, I'm still speechless after that one.
And we're joined by Mark Foley. Mark, interesting race. Looked like you weren't doing too well in the early part of the race, but a charge back at the end there, all over the back end of Leoninen. How did the race go?
Yeah, it was. I found it fairly lonely at the beginning. I mean, the car got better when it was on lower fuel. It's also got quicker as the stints went on. But I think if I could describe it in a word, very economical. I think
economical.
I did the planet some good today. I saved a few polar bears. I was just on boost 2 pretty much the whole time. And I got really good mileage out of it. I was doing better than, George and Tim. That's only because I could hear them on TeamSpeak. I don't know what it was like for us. But I think Samudi's engine was going at the end, so I'm reeling him in, and I could put up to boost 5. But it was only 6/10 in the end, but yeah, it was fun, considering I started 11th, and placed 4th.
Okay, I think we'll go to Tim first, before we go to Anders. I think we'll start with you, Tim. Unfortunately, you were going to be our driver of the day. Anders tipped you to that one. But a rather eventful race. Looked like some collisions, a bit of bumping and bashing, some really, really good moves, some not so good moves.
Yeah.
Sum up your race for us.
I don't know. It's just pretty up and down. I thought I'd have a bit of a time on my own, and
I didn't. Thought I'd be off the pace, and I've never spun out of a, I've never spun out that corner before, and then to do it on the last lap, it's. I think I'm going to go and hang myself tonight.
Yeah, it looked like I had it all done and dusted. I was shocked actually to see you loop it on the exit there. Anyway. An enjoyable race, nonetheless.
It was good fun. Enjoyed.
Well, that matters. Anders, driver of the day.
Thank you.
What a race.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Yeah? Talk us through it then.
That's the last race. I was too slow in the beginning and I felt I was in the way. Andreas made past me and another guy. Yeah, Andreas and Tim. And I started to... A bit of fuel and I got another lap. Yeah, so I was running high boost the last stint and managed to catch Tim, pass him, and on the final lap I heard him in my slipstream and I thought he's gonna outbreak me, and he did, and he spun, and I said I didn't touch him.
I mean, you, obviously, we said you're Mr. Consistent today, and Richie refers to it as a tortoise approach. And what you've done, essentially, is just keep the car on a straight line and look where it's landed you. So is that how you're going to approach the next race? Or?
Yeah, I'm a slow starter.
So, I mean, obviously, going into round four, so it's a halfway point now in the championship. Do you see yourself as a title contender?
I must, because I think I'm in the lead in the championship, so I...
Yeah, he is.
So, yeah, I hope I can keep this up. That would be great.
Yeah, so obviously looking forward to the next round in 2 weeks' time. So, what are you, do you know what the next track is?
No.
Portland.
Portland, okay. Never raced there, so that's going to be a first.
So, I mean, really, I think a fantastic race today. So, I mean, is there any personal highlight for you, Anders, apart from crossing the line?
Sorry, Liam.
Your highlight of the day, Anders. I was going to say, was it a highlight, when Andreas ran a little bit wide and kind of pushed you into the kitty litter? That looked fun.
I was just glad that that kitty litter wasn't that sticky, so I didn't lose that much. And I actually felt that I wasn't those two guys' way, so it was a good thing that happened, because I could calm down a bit and save fuel, and yeah. That was it. The highlight, I don't know, when I crossed the finish line as a winner, perhaps?
Or when you heard Tim slam into the wall, that must be quite nice.
Yeah, that was actually a bit sad. But, yeah. Good race.
Okay, thank you. I think the last driver we have to talk to is Nick Phillips. Slow, steady, consistent race and brought the car to the finish.
Yeah, I mean, lack of practice and just having driven in from Road Atlanta, driving an F1, it was a bit of a different beast. distinct lack of practice, which didn't help either. And yeah, I thought, well, at least get to the end and see where you finish. It was one of those races at the end, and so I'll take 8th place.
Okay, I think that wraps us up, does it? Anything left to say, Liam?
No, just except for a huge thank you, of course, to Rich, who has got your name right this time, I think, maybe.
Amazingly so.
See, there we go, right. So just amazing thank you to everyone here in SRA for this opportunity, and thanks to Richard for commentating with me. I'm sure we'll be back for round four in 2 weeks, and it has been a thrilling race as always, and this series continues to heat up, producing drama and some brilliant racing. So until next time, guys, we will see you on the racetrack and have a fantastic week.